Morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Welcome to all here joining us here in the sanctuary, as well as those joining us online. We're glad you're here. Happy spring. Almost. Tomorrow, March 20th, is the vernal equinox, beginning of spring. So do you like spring? You'd be surprised at the different answers you'll get to that question. If you say yes, you're probably somebody that likes the warmer temperatures maybe, and the green that comes, and the flowers, and thinking about new growth and new beginnings. If you say you don't like spring so much, you may have a dog, and it's mud time of year when you have a dog, and you know about that. And sometimes this, you know, early spring, lots of muddy times. Those of us who say we like spring, we're probably thinking about May and June and planting gardens and things like that. So I think that springtime is sometimes a good metaphor for life sometimes. You know, we may have plans, we may have hopes, we may have dreams, we may have things we want to do, things we want to accomplish. We're looking forward to things that are coming up down the road, but then life happens and the mud comes and you get bogged down and stuck in the mud. Well, if you find yourself in the mud today, we can find both advice and also encouragement in God's word. So where's some advice? How about Psalm 25? And David writes, "Show me your ways, Lord, and teach me your paths. Guide me in your truth and teach me, for you are God my Savior, and my hope is in you all day long." Okay, so if we put our hope in God, what can we hope to get in return? Well, Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 8, verse 28 writes, "And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose." If we can put our hope and trust in him today, if we can trust him with the mud that we're stuck in, we can have confidence that he is working for our good, and that one day the sun will come out and the mud will dry up, at least for a while, until the next storm comes. But hopefully we'll be better equipped for that next storm, whatever it might be. So are you stuck in the mud today? Well, you've come to the right place, because God himself is here through in his spirit. The maker of heaven and earth, Alpha and Omega, he is here with us today. There's more than two or three of us here in the sanctuary, and we've gathered in his name. And so we can have confidence that he is here, sitting next door to you right now as you sit here. Let's call on his name today and trust him with the mud that we may be stuck in today. Let us pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, it's good to be in your house today. We thank you for this new day and for this new opportunity to come into your presence and to worship you. We thank you. Thank you so much for your love and for your faithfulness to us. We thank you for walking with us in every trial and circumstance. Thank you, O Lord, for the confidence we have in knowing that you are walking with us and that you're working for our good. Thank you for the peace that we can have in whatever mud we may be stuck in, when we put our trust and hope in you. We commit this service to you now. We pray that you would work in it. We pray that you would be at the center of all that is said and done. We pray that honor and glory be brought to the name that is above all names, the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, the one who's coming again. Amen. In terms of announcements for the week, just a quick couple of announcements. Men, we're going out tomorrow night. So please plan on meeting us here at the church at 6 or over at Twin Colony at 6:30. Prayer and Bible study continues on Wednesdays at the Parsonage, and you can see some dates coming up in April. One extra announcement, Easter, if you check your calendars, Easter is 3 weeks from today. And so Easter lilies, we want to take a quick poll. If you would like to purchase a lily in honor or memory of somebody, could you speak to me or Christine or the pastor, maybe after service, so we get a quick idea about what the interest might be in buying lilies this year. So if you do that, that would be great. Let's sing a hymn, number 498, More About Jesus. Let's stand together. Thank you. You may be seated.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I wonder, as we go to prayer, is there someone want to share maybe a word of praise? I'd love to hear something that God is doing, maybe an answer to prayer. What is going on? Yes, Cindy.
Physical therapy is going well. You know, difficult at times. But
yep.
I have the best physical therapist.
Good.
You know, she works me hard and encourages me, and she's fine.
Super.
So it keeps me going. And,
good.
You know, hopefully, it will be a good result in the future. Yeah. Start exercising again without much pain.
Good. Glad to hear it. Anyone else? Yes, Chris.
You know, I just, most of you know that I am moving. And I just wanted to say, sometimes I don't always show it when we're moving things around and getting rid of some of my things that I've had for a long time. But my daughter and my son-in-law, which I don't consider a son-in-law, I consider another son, and Raymond, they've all been wonderful to me and helping me, which is, I'm very grateful, because not many people have children that are willing to do.
True. What can we be praying for? Requests.
Also, can you pray for Brian? Because last week he was sick and he never cancels, but he has a stomach bug, I guess.
Is that the coach?
Yeah, that's the coach.
His name is Brian?
Brian McAdoo, yes.
Bill?
Yes, for my friend Amy, in the last couple of months, has lost both of her parents.
Who? You said Amy, right? Yes. Anyone else? A couple we want to pray for Morse. He's out of the hospital. He's back at Walcott Hall, so that's a good thing. So continue to pray for him. And then Penny is in the hospital. Sounding better than she was, but we're going to continue to pray for her.
Is Morris's
son
still here, or
no? I don't know, to be honest.
Great,
thanks,
yes.
Anyone else? Then let's go to prayer. Father God, we thank you so much for this opportunity to be in your house today. In your house, Lord. So I think there's times we take that for granted. Yeah, we're going to church. We're going to that place where we go to church. But Lord, let us never forget that this is your house. And what a special privilege it is to walk through those doors, knowing that you're happy to see us. No matter what this week held, I believe you're happy to see us here. You love us. That's never changed. Thank you, Lord, so much for that. Lord, you are a good and mighty and awesome God. Lord, we could stand here all day. And first of all, probably we could share all kinds of things that you've done in the past. Answers to prayer. Things you've brought us through. And each of us, if we were honest, could share a lot of those. But Lord, we could also share all the burdens of our hearts, all those things that have us awake at night, that we worry about. And I know that none of those is beyond your control. Lord, you can do something about everything that we might bring up to you. And I believe you want to do something about all these things we bring to you. You don't want us to be carrying around these huge burdens. You want to help us with them. So Lord, we just give you thanks for that today. Lord, I do pray for those who are going through some sicknesses right now. It seems like cold and things are going around. I want to lift up Brian and Lord, others that probably have dealt with it, you know, sinus and cough and all those spring things that come, Lord, are probably going to come. Lord, help us through them right now. I pray that they would be quick and kind of run its course and go away, Lord. But Lord, I do want to lift up those friend Amy got, losing both parents. We just want to lift her up to you today, God. Pray, Lord, that you would bring comfort to her and help her through this time as she grieves. Father, we want to lift up Morris, and we thank you, Lord, that he is out of the hospital. We just pray that you continue to be with him and watch over him right now, Lord, that those nurses around him would do their very best for him. So we lift him up, Lord. We pray the same for Penny. God, I pray that you would continue to help her and watch over her in that hospital, and that soon she might be able to go back to Litchfield Woods, Lord. But we just lift them both up to you, God. I pray that you would be with them. Oh, Lord, you are just an awesome God. We're so thankful to be with you this morning. God, I believe that you want to help us in this life. Lord, there's things you want to teach us, challenge us with, and yes, sometimes convict us of things, God, because you know the path that we're walking on. You know the end result of those. We don't. So there's times you want to keep us away from those things. Have us change course because you create us, Lord. You know what the very best for us. So, Lord, as we are with you this morning, we ask that through your Holy Spirit, you would teach us this morning. Yes, remind us of your love. Put that arm around us for those who need it this morning, God. And we just thank you so much for this time that we can spend with you. And I pray all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Scripture reading for the morning is found in the book of John. I'll be reading John chapter 11, verses 1 through 27. Now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sisters sent word to Jesus, "Lord, the one you love is sick." When he heard this, Jesus said, "This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was for two more days. And then he said to his disciples, "Let us go back to Judea." "But Rabbi," they said, "a short while ago the Jews there tried to stone you, and yet you want to go back?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Anyone who walks in the daytime will not stumble, for they see by the world's light. It is when a person walks at night that they stumble, for they have no light." After he said this, he went on to tell them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I'm going there to wake him up." His disciples replied, "Lord, if he sleeps, will he get better?" Jesus had been speaking of his death, but his disciples thought he meant natural sleep. So then he told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. And for your sake, I am glad that I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." Then Thomas, also known as Didymus, said to the rest of the disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha answered, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she replied. "I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who has come into the world." May God add a blessing to the reading of his word.
Okay, as we stand together, as the worship team comes forward, I just want to share one quick verse. In John chapter 15, verse 13. Jesus says, "Greater love has no one than this, that he lay down his life for his friends." My friends, Jesus loves us more than anyone ever will. He laid down his life for us. And that's the journey we make now to the cross. Let us come and worship right now.
Remember your people, remember your church.
Amen. May be seated. Let's pray. Lord, we pause right now to seek your face and to ask, Lord, what is it you want to teach us this morning? And we ask, God, that your Holy Spirit would be the one speaking right now. This is your time, Lord. We give it to you. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, if you know anything about photography, you know the importance of having the camera lens in focus before triggering the shutter. You can set the right shutter speed. You can open the lens to its proper setting. But if that lens is not in focus, then the picture will be worthless. Anyone who's trying to sell something these days knows the importance of having an accurate focus on the market for which a product is intended. Now, whether you're trying to sell soap or soft drinks, it's necessary to know exactly which people will most likely purchase that product. And you need to know what age group or sector of the public to focus that advertising on. Well, Jesus realized that if people were going to follow him, and if his followers were going to be truly effective Christians in the world, then they needed to know exactly who he was. They also need to know precisely what was exactly involved in being a Christian. And this is probably one reason why he asked that simple question, but all important question. Who do people say the Son of Man is? And then he asks again, and he refines the question by asking, who do you say I am? It was a hospital waiting room, and there was one rather self-important individual who was getting impatient and unwilling to wait any longer. He barged in and demanded to be seen by the doctor. He said, don't you know who I am? And at this, the secretary calmly pressed the button on the microphone of her loudspeaker system and asked the waiting patients, I have a gentleman here who doesn't know who he is. Could someone please come and assist him in finding out? Thank you. Now, if you or I were to go around asking our friends, you know, what do people say about me? Or who do you say I am? And we might take it as evidence of either their pride or maybe their dementia. But what people believe and say about Jesus Christ will determine their destiny. See, your confession concerning Jesus Christ literally is a matter of life or death. Now, hopefully you remember this question from last week if you were here. And this question is so important that we see another form of it being asked to someone else in our scripture that Rob read for us this morning. Well, the story in our scripture happened just a couple of chapters before the triumphal entry. So we're getting closer. And immediately after this story, some who had witnessed the amazing miracle went straight to the Pharisees and reported what they had seen. And this set in motion a meeting of the Sanhedrin to discuss what must be done about Jesus. And of course, we know the result of this. They began to look for an opportunity to arrest him. But that time was not yet here in our scripture. Jesus is still preparing his followers. And what we read about here in John 11 is a big part of that preparation. This is a big part of what it means that Jesus is the Christ or the Messiah. So let's set the stage for a minute on what's happening here. There is this family of two sisters and a brother. Jesus loved this family. often as he's traveling this way, he would stay with them. There was Mary, there was Martha, and Lazarus. And they were in Bethany, which was not very far from Jerusalem at all. And we find out that Lazarus is very sick. The two sisters send word to Jesus because they believe that he can help them. They had witnessed many of his miracles and believe in his power, and they look to Jesus for help. Well, we read about this belief in verse 21 where Martha says to Jesus, she said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God can give you whatever you ask." And then Mary, her sister, echoes the same belief in verse 32 when she says, when Mary reached a place where Jesus saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." Now, obviously, these two sisters wanted to come to Jesus to take their burden away. And why wouldn't they? Right? We do the same thing. We pray all the time for Jesus to take away whatever it is that burdens us. And there's nothing wrong with those requests, by the way. It's very difficult for us to understand why we must suffer through pain or disease or the loss of life. We just want God to take it away. And again, I don't think we need to feel bad for these prayers. What we're doing is bringing our burdens to God, and he tells us to do that. But there are times when the answer is no, or not yet. And that can be very difficult for us to handle. And part of the problem is that our perspective is very limited compared to that of Jesus. Look at verse 4. Jesus says, "This sickness will end in death." Will not end in death, excuse me. "Notice for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." So the first thing we see here is that Jesus does hear their request. This statement from Jesus is right after the message is relayed to him that the one you love is sick. And God always hears our prayers. Not because somehow our prayers are extra special or because even that we deserve it, but because he chooses to hear our prayers. My friends, he always hears. You're not going to get a busy signal or a message telling you to leave a message and he'll call you back. No, that doesn't happen. He is never too busy to listen to the cares and concerns of his followers. Again, Jesus said, "This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." And what a miraculous truth this is. Suffering doesn't just happen for no reason. But there's a plan and there's a purpose behind it. Now, here is a little secret that we need to know, though, about that. Sometimes that plan and purpose has nothing to do with us. Sometimes it does, but oftentimes it does not. Really, what we read happening here had nothing to do with Mary or Martha or even Lazarus. However, God was going to be glorified through it. Sometimes the things we go through are for our benefit. They are to make us stronger. I think of this passage from Peter, where he says this, "In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. These have come so that your faith of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may be proved genuine and may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed." And sometimes that is the case. But if that's how we look at every single unpleasant thing that we go through, then we're going to ask, we might be asking God, "You're enough, leave me alone." But listen, I do not believe that every bad thing we go through is something that's been sent to us by God. I just don't believe that. He does not zap us every time we sin. If that were the case, some of us would be pretty crispy, if you know what I mean. But listen to what Paul says in Romans 8, verse 18. He says, "I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us." Listen, our 70, 80, or 90 or more years of this life, no matter how much suffering we may go through, will even begin to compare with an eternity of living with God in heaven. This life is a drop in the bucket compared to what we're going to spend with him someday. Now look at verses 5 and 6. Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. Yet when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was 2 more days. Jesus loved this family. That's been well documented. That was not the issue here at all. But yet, he still waited 2 more days before coming. Sometimes when we ask God for something, the answer is yes. Sometimes the answer is no. I think of Paul's prayer for the thorn in the flesh. Sometimes the answer is to wait. So this morning we see this big teachable moment. Now remember, Jesus is in the process of preparing his followers for what's going to happen soon, namely his death at the hands of the religious leaders. So keep that in mind. Now Jesus could have come as soon as he heard that Lazarus was sick, and the sisters are correct when they say that in a few verses that Lazarus would not have died if he was there. We know that Jesus has the power to heal. We've seen that again and again. But think of the lesson they're going to learn. Not only does Jesus have the power to heal, but listen, he also has power over death. This truth is something that his followers are going to have to hold on to, especially when they see he himself die on the cross. Verses 14 and 15. So then he told them plainly, Lazarus is dead, and for your sake, I'm glad I was not there, so that you may believe, but let us go to him. Talk about a teachable moment here. Now I'm sure the healings he performed were incredible. Walking on the water, seeing that must have been pretty cool. Calming the storm with a word surely must have opened their eyes. But having the ability to raise someone from the dead made him more than just some good teacher. Made him the Christ. But sadly, they seem to forget this lesson. But again, like I said last week, sometimes the grief is so difficult on Friday that we can't see through to Sunday. And then we see that most important question. In verse 17, we read about Jesus' arrival in Bethany. We're told that Lazarus had already been dead for 4 days. And there was a group around the family helping them to grieve. And upon hearing that Jesus arrived, Martha goes out to greet him. Look at verses 21 and 22. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now, God will give you whatever you ask. Now, it goes without saying that Martha was obviously disappointed in the outcome of the situation. How could she not? But notice that she does not question Jesus. She does not turn her back on him. Rather, she has kept her faith in him. In other words, we can say that by her faith in Jesus, she was saying, thy will be done, not mine. Now, I want to look at the key verses in our scripture. Verses 23 and 26. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha answered, I know he will rise again in the resurrection of the last day. And Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? Now we know that certainly Lazarus was going to rise again. Even if Martha did not quite understand exactly what Jesus was saying here specifically. And of course we know that the resurrection of the dead to happen at his second coming will be for all who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. But Jesus makes that promise to Martha on that day, and also remains his promise to everyone today that trusts in his name. Your brother will rise again. Gary will rise again. Hermine will rise again. Trudy will rise again. David will rise again. My mom will rise again. Annie will rise again. It goes on and on. Are you listening to this wonderful truth this morning, my friends? We must not hear this promise from Jesus like someone who's just grasping at anything that brings comfort in grief, right? You know the things we hear at funerals, and people are always well-intentioned. You know the thing, always up in a better place. She's with her husband again. Uncle Harry's up there playing the harp. Or grandma's helping the angels throw out the rain. And I know people's intentions. But Jesus says here, he will rise again. But please hear this. Only Jesus can truly make that promise. Because only he claimed victory over death once and for all. And that's what happens on Easter Sunday. Praise the Lord. Now, hear this wonderful passage with that truth in mind, 1 Corinthians 15. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, let's get back to our scripture. Jesus has given the promise that he will rise again. And Martha then replies, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. And what she says is absolutely true here. And we know that Lazarus will once again be resurrected on that day. Because he is going to go on to die again. But Jesus wants his followers to see that he has the power over death now. Listen to what he says. I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. Whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? Now, this passage has caused, I think, many to be confused at times. This passage is often read at funerals. And I know there are many who hear it and think, now, wait a minute. What do you mean that he will never die? You know, he's lying right there in the casket. So let's take this little but important passage piece by piece. He says, I am the resurrection and the life. Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. I don't just have the power to resurrect someone. As he says in the book of Revelation, chapter 1, I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forever and ever. And I hold the keys of death and Hades. We read wonderful passages in God's word, like in Isaiah 25, in Revelation 21, where it talks about swallowing up death forever, and there will be no more death. And this is made possible by the one who is the resurrection and the life. Next, notice what he says. Whoops. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. This one's not super confusing. If someone dies believing in Jesus Christ as their Savior, then one day they will be resurrected back to life. I think most understand that one. But then he adds, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die. When he says will never die, this means they will not die a second death. Say, well, wait a minute. You just said there's not going to be any more death. And you're right. When Jesus returns, all will be raised to life. In Hebrews 9, verse 27 to 28, here's what we read. Just as man is destined to die once, we're all going to die unless it comes first, and after that to face judgment, so Christ was sacrificed once to take away the sins of many people. And he will appear a second time, not to bear sin, but to bring salvation to those who are waiting for him. Now, the judgment mentioned here is very important to understand this passage in John 11. That judgment is when he separates the sheep from the goats, the wheat from the chaff, the evil from the good. And in Matthew 13, verse 49, read this. This is how it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come and separate the wicked from the righteous and throw them into the fiery furnace where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. This fiery furnace talked about here that Jesus mentioned is where the second death will occur for those who did not trust in Jesus. So again, back to our scripture. Jesus makes it very personal now. He looks at Martha and says, do you believe this? Or who do you say I am? And Martha answers, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God who was to come into the world. Her answer sounds a lot like Peter from last week, doesn't it? She does believe. Her faith was strong in Jesus. Let's move on. Because we see here his great emotion. Verse 33, further on in John 11. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. And then verse 35 is the shortest and one of the most powerful verses in the Bible, where it says, Jesus wept. And we often point to this little verse, saying that it shows how much Jesus cared about his friends. I know I've pointed it out many times myself. Because think about it. Jesus wept for his friends, even though he knew his plan was to raise Lazarus from the dead. But I think there's even more to that. Notice verse 33 here points out that not only did Jesus see his friend weeping, but he also saw the Jews who had come along with her also weeping. And we see that he was troubled. This can also mean he was agitated. It seems his great emotion here goes beyond just those who are mourning around him. Could it be that he was troubled because it was not supposed to be like this? Man was created to live forever in peace with God. However, suffering and death are a result of sin. Jesus wept. Would John have mentioned this if it was just Jesus kind of getting choked up a bit? Now, I'm not sure, but I feel like Jesus weeping here could have been more like sobbing. See, it's not going to be very long from now. He'll be shedding tears of blood in the garden. And I wonder, was he now thinking about where he was to go soon, namely to Calvary and the cross? Jesus knew that he was their only hope. And yet when he looked around at the others gathered there besides his friends and followers, what he saw from them was rejection and hatred. And I wonder how many in that crowd that day were also in the crowd at his trials, shouting, crucify him, crucify him. Now surely, Jesus showing this emotion is a beautiful illustration of his humanity and his love. But what comes next also gives us a powerful illustration, but this time of his deity and his power. And lastly, we see his power over death. Look at verses 38 and 39. Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days. You see, the situation with Lazarus was hopeless in their eyes. They believed the spirit stayed with the body for 3 days and then left for good. At least some believe that. So even if Jesus was considering bringing Lazarus back to life, they thought that it was too late. Listen, nothing is impossible with God. We read on, verse 44. Then Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. And when he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out! And the dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped in strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to him, take off the grave clothes and let him go. Jesus said, if you believed, you would see the glory of God. If our faith is too small, maybe it's our idea of God that's too small. Remember, he is the resurrection and the life. He holds the key of death and Hades. Jesus prays, Father, I thank you that you've heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. again, another confirmation that he is the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of God. And then we see his power over death. When he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" And the dead man came out with just a word. Indeed, Jesus does have the power over life and death. And now we know without a doubt that when Jesus says he will rise again, he has the power to accomplish that. And he can do it with just a word. And then we read these last couple of verses, 45 to 47. "Therefore, many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary and had seen what Jesus did put their faith in him. But some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what Jesus had done. And then the chief priests and the Pharisees called the meeting of the Sanhedrin." Now, I cannot imagine witnessing all of that and not having faith in him. See, this simply does not happen, ever. Only Jesus has the victory over death. But we read here that others went directly to the Pharisees to report what they had witnessed. Now, I suppose that some of them, maybe some had decent intentions. Maybe they wanted the Pharisees to know that, hey, this Jesus, he's for real. The Pharisees weren't interested in that. Someone with that kind of power could be detrimental to their power, because this is real power. So they began to meet to consider how they're going to deal with him. And we know the end result, because this was all part of Jesus' journey to the cross. So thankful that we do serve Jesus, the Christ, the Messiah. And we can call him Lord today. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for your word. We thank you for this beautiful story of your power over death. Lord, we know that it's going to touch all of us someday. We are so thankful that we can have faith in your Son, the one who holds the keys of death in his hand. Thank you that because of his power over death, someday, if we believe in you as our Savior, Lord, we will also have victory over death. We long for that day that we can begin spending eternity with you. Thank you, Lord. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Yes, we all stand together as the worship team comes up and sing, "Be Thou My Vision." This is number 460 in the hymn. Yes, and the third verse on here might be a little different from the hymnal, so keep that. With me, Lord. seated for a moment.